Today's story is about the loudest rock band in the world, a pair of folk-singing, super-straight-looking siblings from Connecticut, and a shrapnel-producing, hair-singeing, ear-ringing explosion on live television that shockingly introduced America to an instrument-smashing British band who managed, in their very first appearance, to blow a major U.S. television network right off the air.
CBS presents this program in color.
All of this mayhem took place in 1967, when television was mostly about escapism. Gilligan's Island.
Just sit right back and you'll hear a tale of a fateful trip.
The Green Hornet. Time Tunnel. Flipper.
They call him Flipper, Flipper, faster than lightning.
Green Acres.
Green Acres is the place to be. Farm living is the life for me.
And the Beverly Hillbillies.
Come and listen to my story about a man named Jed. A poor mountaineer barely kept his family fed.
But somehow, against all odds, a pair of innocuous-looking, folk-singing brothers were offered their very own variety show on national television. An especially big deal at the time, as there were only three major American networks.
The following program is brought to you in living color on NBC.
CBS presents this program in color.
So what was the catch? They were being pitted against the competition-chewing last six shows before them crushing Bonanza. The juggernaut of Bonanza ruled Sunday nights. In fact, all the other networks called Sunday night Death Valley. So the CBS network felt it had nothing to lose by giving the brothers a shot. Initially left alone by the network, the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour started off very non-controversial. But the brothers slowly crafted what would become a groundbreakingly controversial television show featuring brilliantly cutting-edge writers, including head writer Mason Williams, who also wrote and performed the big 1968 Grammy-winning hit, Classical Gas. Steve Martin.
And they go, and now, ladies and gentlemen, let's bring out Johnny Duke.
Hey, good evening.
And Rob Reiner, who went on to co-star as Meathead on All in the Family, and he later directed a bunch of major Hollywood movie hits, including Spinal Tap, A Few Good Men, When Harry Met Sally, and The Princess Bride. Bob Einstein, later of Super Dave Osborne fame.
Call it karma, call it vibes, call it ESP. Call it what you will. The point is that I sense danger and react like a cat.
And don't do anything until I say go. What they're going to try to do is crush me with an 11-ton metal...
The Smothers Brothers never used a laugh track. They preferred to get a completely genuine audience reaction. In its day, the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour was the pop culture equivalent of Saturday Night Live. The brothers loved to showcase, and in many cases introduce for the first time on television, some of the newest, hippest acts of the day, the coolest of the cool, people like Jimi Hendrix. Donovan.
Way down below the ocean, where I want gonna be, she may be.
Harry Nielsen.
Now think about your trouble.
Ike and Tina Turner. Paul Revere and the Raiders. Buffalo Springfield.
There's something happening here. What it is ain't exactly clear.
Kenny Rogers and the First Edition. Steppenwolf.
Let the sound take you away.
The Birds.
I'm going back.
The Temptations. The Turtles. Jefferson Airplane. And the Doors.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, now touch me, babe.
Just to name a famous few. They all got a chance to introduce themselves to brand new audiences during the Smothers Brothers Sunday night time slot. So, as the show developed, the Smothers Brothers material became more and more brazen and politically volatile, eventually resulting in regular fights with the network's censors. At one point, the show was even censored by the censors for doing a sketch on censorship.
Good script.
Nothing funny in this. Here you are, boys, we're through censoring your show.
Eventually, when the CBS network had had enough, they angrily fired the Smothers Brothers and yanked the show off the air mid-season. It is of note that the brothers later sued the network and won. Cha-ching! But before all the censorship and suing mayhem, mayhem of a different sort was afoot. On Sunday evening, September 17, 1967, the Smothers Brothers were about to introduce their American audience to a loud and scruffy British band called The Who. And almost no one in America knew who they were. Now, to tie this all together, let's go back to 1964 and the beginnings of The who would eventually be considered the godfathers of punk, the pioneers of the rock opera, and one of the very first groups to creatively integrate synthesizers into rock and roll. And once they had their complete lineup in place, they seemed to get wilder by the minute. By the time of their Smothers Brothers American TV debut performance, The Who already had a reputation in England, not only for producing incredible records, but also for having an incendiary live show. They always seemed slightly dangerous on stage. In fact, The Who have been described as one of the most electrifying physical live acts of all time. They also became known as the world's loudest rock band, stacking their marshals and at one point setting the Guinness Book World Record for the loudest concert in the world. The Who, four guys. You had the man who started the band, tough guy, frontman Roger Daltrey, spinning his microphone and belting out powerful vocals. Artistic Pete Townsend wrote all the songs while his guitar spewed increasing teen anger. Strong, silent John Entwistle, the Ox, or Thunder Fingers, thumping out impressively loud and fast bass with what looked like minimal, almost stoic, effort. It is of note that in 2002, at the age of 57, John would go out in what he most certainly would have described as a blaze of glory, dying of a heart attack from cocaine use, in bed with a stripper, in the Hard Rock Hotel, in Paradise, Nevada. Classic. And then finally, you had the silly, heroic, tragic, and magnificent Keith Moon, the Loon. Keith took drumming and rock and roll craziness to a whole new level. I'm going to get back to Keith Moon in a moment when I set up the night of their performance. The Who's members have been described as lead singer Daltrey, Entwistle on lead bass, Moon on lead drums, and Townsend on lead guitar. Commenting on the band itself, Roger Daltrey has said, "It was a very volatile group of people, more like a gang, actually." When Roger Daltrey invited Pete Townsend to join the band, Pete has said, "It was the greatest moment of my life, and I've despised Roger ever since." Pete, by the way, developed his windmill-swinging guitar arm style by first seeing Keith Richards of the Rolling Stones doing something similar. Pete was once pontificating to the press about the grandeur of rock, and he said, "It's the absolute ultimate vehicle for self-destruction. There's nothing as effective." Over the years, Pete Townsend has proved himself equally capable of writing catchy, tight, three-minute hit singles all the way up to full-on rock operas like Tommy and Quadrophenia. So, the band got together in 1964. They put out a few singles, but the first one to really go anywhere was I Can't Explain in 1965. Townsend said the song had a similarity to the Kinks' hit All Day and All of the Night. For the recording of I Can't Explain, their record producer brought in a vocal group called the Ivy League to handle the backing vocals, finding the guys in The Who lacked the finesse he was looking for. Bringing in professional substitutes was the style of many producers at the time. In the case of the Beatles, George Martin didn't think drummer Pete Best was up to snuff for their first single, Love Me Do. The Beatles fired Pete Best and brought in Ringo, but George Martin was also unhappy with Ringo's, quote, unsteady drumming. Ringo was reduced to shaking a tambourine for the session, something he said it took him years to forgive George Martin for. In the case of The Who's first big single, the producer also tried to bring in a replacement drummer, but Keith Moon threatened to kill him if he didn't take his equipment and get out. No one doubted Moon's intentions, especially not the session drummer, who immediately took the hint. And, most famously, and before Led Zeppelin was formed, the producer also brought in a session guitarist, Jimmy Page. Much has been made of Page's contribution to The Who's breakout song. He's an accredited backing session player, confirmed by the band to have played rhythm guitar behind Townsend's slashing riff. Page has said the session could easily have gone off without him. "I didn't need to be there," he later told Rolling Stone. "I was just playing rhythm guitar in the background, but the main riff," he confirmed, "was all Pete. He was roaring, man." UK rock fans pushed I Can't Explain up the singles charts to number 8, and the band was officially on its way. They followed it up with Anyway, Anyhow, Anywhere, also in 1965, and it also rose into the top 10 in the UK. The guitar feedback in the song, although not the first to be heard on a record, the Beatles' I Feel Fine takes that credit, it's thought to be the first guitar solo with feedback. Their next single was My Generation, also recorded in 1965. This now classic rocker features one of the most iconic rock lyrics of all time. I hope I die before I get old. The story goes that a young, fresh, hip Pete was driving his brand new fancy car through a posh part of London when a sophisticated older woman sneered at him from her car as he cruised by. Townsend says, "I hope I die before I get old," is about everything she represented to him. Another version of the story says that Pete was inspired by the Queen Mother, who allegedly had Townsend's 1935 Packard hearse towed off the street in Belgravia because she was offended by the sight of it during her daily drives through the neighborhood. Daltrey not only delivers My Generation with explosive anger, but he adds a unique stammering, frustrated stutter. Various stories exist as to the reason for his distinct delivery. Some say it was mimicking the sound made by British mods trying to talk when on drugs, speed mainly. But their record producer insisted that it was simply one of those happy accidents that sometimes happen in a studio, and he thought they should keep it. Daltrey has also commented that he hadn't rehearsed My Generation before the recording session, that he was nervous, and that he wasn't quite able to hear his own voice through the monitors. The stutter happened as he tried to fit the lyrics to the music as best he could. The band decided it worked, and they kept it. The BBC initially refused to play My Generation because they didn't want to offend people who stuttered. But, oddly enough, they reversed their decision after the song began to climb the charts. Funny how that goes. Stuttering also allowed Daltrey to creatively imply some swearing in their live shows. Why don't you all just fade away? My Generation also featured one of the very first bass solos in rock history from Thunderfingers. And My Generation has been named the 11th greatest rock song of all time by Rolling Stone magazine on its list of the 500 greatest songs of all time. So, as The Who began to build a reputation as one of the most physically electrifying and ear-splitting live acts, they also became known for their groundbreaking practice of destroying their instruments on stage. Pete Townsend said it was an accident the first time he smashed his guitar. The Who were playing in a small, cramped room in West London. The ceiling was damp with condensation. The room was smoky and smelled of sweat and stale beer. While they were playing, Pete says, "I began to scrape my howling Rickenbacker guitar up and down my microphone stand as I violently thrust my guitar up into the air. I feel a terrible shudder as the sound goes from a roar to a rattling growl, and I look up to see my guitar's broken head as I pull it away from the hole I've just punched in the low ceiling. It is at this moment that I make a split-second decision, and in a mad frenzy, I thrust the damaged guitar up into the ceiling over and over again. What had been a clean break becomes a splintered mess. I hold the guitar up to the crowd triumphantly. I haven't smashed it, I've sculpted it for them. I throw the shattered guitar carelessly to the ground, pick up my brand new Rickenbacker 12-string, and continue the show." A rule for being cool: always make your mistakes look as if you meant to do them. Rolling Stone magazine considers this destructive event so important that it is one of their 50 moments that changed rock and roll. So, that's where the Smothers Brothers were at, and that's where The Who were at when September 17, 1967 rolled around and they were about to perform their U.S. television debut. They say you never get a second chance to make a first impression. Planned or not, crazy Keith Moon was about to make sure that nobody watching CBS that night would ever forget the moment. The moment The Who blew up the television and temporarily knocked CBS right off the air. Now, Keith had taken to filling his bass drum with a little flash powder to make a loud noise and a bright flash. He wanted to add to the instrument-smashing mayhem that went on in front of him when they finished their shows. By the way, some of the things Moon went on to do later in his career would include driving his brand new car into a swimming pool on his 21st birthday, nailing all his hotel room furniture to the ceiling, which earned them a lifetime ban from the Holiday Inn, and he once chased Pete Townsend through a train car with a knife. One time Keith Moon took horse tranquilizers and passed out over his drums mid-set in San Francisco. 19-year-old Scott Halpin was recruited from the audience to finish the show when Townsend yelled out, "Is there anybody out there who can play the drums?" Halpin was given a shot of brandy for his nerves before sitting down at his first drum set in a year. "I really admire their stamina," Scott said later. "I only played 3 songs and I was completely exhausted." Even Keith Moon's neighbor, movie star Steve McQueen, was fair game for his bizarre behavior. McQueen had recently starred as a prisoner in The Great Escape, and Moon would often march past McQueen's house dressed as a Nazi. So, hiding a few extra explosives in his drum kit was par for the course for Moon. Now, on the afternoon in question, some say that Keith got the stagehand drunk during the afternoon, bribing him with shots of brandy and getting him to add more and more powder to give things that extra kick. And Keith may have added even more powder himself when the stagehand wasn't looking. Hard to say. But all of this was going on without the rest of the band, or anyone else, having a clue. The Who did 2 songs that night. First, I Can See for Miles, their latest hit, and then, for their final performance, My Generation. Now, some reports say that between them, Moon and the stagehand packed 3 times the normal amount of explosives. Others say it was more like 10 times the amount Moon normally used to close out a Who concert. Either way, when it blew, the explosion took the network, the audience, the Smothers Brothers, and even the Who themselves completely by surprise. When Tommy Smothers had introduced the group, he had told the audience they were gonna be surprised by what happens. They were, as was he. And I want to remind you again how tame television was at that time, mostly rose-colored glasses stuff. This had to have been absolutely shocking to those watching at home. Townsend took the blast to the back of his head. As he emerges from a cloud of smoke, you can see him patting down his hair to make sure it wasn't on fire. Keith Moon can be seen launching off his perch, grabbing his arm and rolling around in pain as he reportedly received shrapnel injuries to his arm from an exploded cymbal. As confusion reigned, Tommy Smothers even got in on the fun, his mouth agape with shock as Pete removes Tommy's acoustic guitar and smashes it to bits. And there you have it, one of the most seminal moments in rock and roll history. And a historic event that helped make The Who household names in America overnight.